Good morning, good afternoon, good day for all of you. Thank you for coming. I hope John and William will join me here in picture pretty soon. But my name is Dee Dee Long. I'm the director. There we go. Hey, John. Hey, Will. I am the chair of the board of directors for the Fulbright Association, and I'm very happy to to welcome all of you to the 2021 annual business meeting. Sorry we could not do this in person, but to some extent it's kind of fun to know that we can reach people who wouldn't have otherwise been able to come to an annual conference in person. So it's nice to be able to do this. I have noticed that some people are saying hello in the chat box. That's wonderful. Please introduce yourself, say hi. That will be great. And then I'd also like to say that we're going to spend the first part of the meeting talking through, John, if you can go to the agenda. We'll be giving a presentation between the three of us. And then but as you come up with questions you might have, concerns or anything, and you want to send those ahead of time, feel free to put those in the Q&A. And then hopefully we'll have plenty of time for discussion. Can open it up if you've got anything on your mind. We would absolutely love to hear from you, but very pleased to see people with us today. So this gives you an idea of the way this is going to work. We're going to just go through some information, past and present and future, that you think we'd like you to know. And so I'm going to go ahead and ask John to go to the next slide. The board this year has been busy. We're usually always busy, but in terms of the priorities for the board of directors, of course, we've been dealing with year two of the pandemic. That obviously shifts the kind of work that we do. But basically, when I was looking at these, I would think that the same strategies or the same priorities would be true of any board at any given time. It's you're constantly evolving and changing, but at the same time, I feel like what I've been saying a lot this year is let's keep our eye on the ball, get through the pandemic, keep our membership energized, and just keep moving forward. And I feel like we have set our priorities well. We did completed a very lengthy strategic planning process in 2020, which allowed us to implement that in 2021. And really the goal of the board has been to support the work. We came up with strategic objections that we basically handed off to our very capable ED and his team, his staff, and we're there to support and help him deliver those. As a reminder, our strategic plan, we had three goals. One, build community among members. Two, strengthen the Fulbright program. And three, improve and sustain the organization's financial performance. And I feel like we have held steady and moved forward on all of those issues. The second priority, of course, is good governance. And that should always be a priority for a board. It is our job, basically, to secure the association's longevity and well-being. And that's what we've worked hard to do. I'm very pleased to say that I feel like the association is alive and well with strong health. So very happy about that. And then the third is probably something that no members should ever even have to worry about. But as a board itself, when we couldn't travel and we did all of our meetings by Zoom, we spent time looking at our own procedures, our policies. How can we be more efficient? How can we make sure we've got all ears to the membership and keep in front of the mission of the association. So we've been hard at work, but glad to see the end of the year coming, because I don't know about you, but I'm very looking forward to 2022. I'd like to see in-person exchange happening. And so we're looking forward to all the things that we're gonna be able to do in 2022 that we just haven't been able to do quite yet. So I wanna give some shout outs and recognition, of course. We have an outstanding board of directors. I have had the privilege of having a team of leaders with me to work with me this year. And that includes Cynthia Baldwin as vice chair, Will Vokey as treasurer, Olku Rowe as secretary, and Carolyn Levander has chaired our governance nominations and done a great job. Go ahead and change, John. We also have committees that are always trying to pay attention, offer good advice, be a focus group for the staff to make sure that we're in sync and giving them the guidance they need when they need it. 75th anniversary committee worked very hard on planning. The results of some of that planning you'll see actually more in 2022 than 2021. We have an advocacy advisory committee. Thanks to Melanie Horton's done a great job. We had a diversity and inclusion task force. I can't say enough about Leland Lazarus' good work in putting together a huge number of programs for us this year, especially with Fulbright in the classroom. And then a programs advisory committee that is our umbrella group that looks over all of our programming, including our travel program, which is a subcommittee led by Mary Stan. Keep going. Okay, we do have some changes on the national board. At the end of this year, we are gonna be very sad to say goodbye to two long-term members. They've both served out their 2-3 year terms. This would be Nada Glick and Don Sparks. They have been tremendously important to the voice of governance for us, and we're gonna miss them very much. Of course, we're gonna retain their energy and enthusiasm and passion as members of the association, but unfortunately we won't have them on our board anymore. So we just wanna acknowledge their great service to the organization. We're happy to welcome to the board David Maxwell. David will be an outstanding addition. He now makes two past university presidents that are on our board of directors, which just adds an enormous wealth of experience and knowledge to the group. So we're very happy to have him. He is president emeritus of Drake University, and we'll be welcoming him in January. January also will bring new officers to the board. Keep it rotating, keep it fresh. Very, very excited to have Cynthia Baldwin step up to the role as chair, followed by Carolyn Lavander again as the vice chair. Will, we can't lose him as the treasurer, we're keeping him on. And then Elbrin Kimmelman will be the secretary. So those are the officers of the association for 2022. Next, John. Okay, so very quickly, John's gonna take the role of telling you what's happening next year. I just wanted to go back through some things that were highlighted in 2021. Most specifically, this is an opportunity for us to just thank you all. You know, the board of directors does the governance part of the work, but where you really are energized is by all the activity and engagement of our members itself. So just a lot of thank yous to all the members of the association. We couldn't begin to name all of them. We started down this path. So if you're not on this list, doesn't mean that we don't absolutely appreciate your work. But we've had a lot of programming happen in 2021 that took the work of volunteers, starting with the launch of the Fulbright Forum. These were our digital programs that were put into place throughout the year, which looked at different themes and topics. Those were just the first year of that, showed us kind of what we need to do for the future. And we're always looking for, these were great topics that were discussed. And a lot of you, or hopefully some of you, were presenters on those programs. Thank you so, so much for being a part of that. And if you ever have an idea that you'd like to take the lead on and help develop an hour-long forum, you let us know. Please get in touch with John Bader. Our advocacy efforts were, I think, extremely successful this year in that we couldn't go to the Hill. So the staff organized congressional meetings through Zoom and conference calls. Those were amazing. And not only were they rather very successful, but we were able to extend the states from which our members were able to come, because they didn't have to go too far, and meet with congressional delegations. So we had meetings set up as far from Alaska, Montana, Hawaii, Arizona. These folks would never normally have been able to make it to DC. So that was very, very successful. And I really want to thank all of you who participated. Also, just in terms of participating in the letter writing campaigns that we had this year with Afghanistan, with some other things, you all are just amazing. And yeah, it makes such a difference. So thank you very, very much. I feel like I had something else to say on the advocacy that I can't remember. Oh, I do. I have one more thing. I just wanted to do a shout out to John Bader, who wouldn't have otherwise done this, but one of the other important contributions to the 75th year this year was an op-ed piece that he did that was published by The Hill called At 75, the Fulbright Deserves Respect and More Funding. And I do encourage all of you to take a look at that. It was a great piece and it got a lot of attention and praise. So that's just another little shout out. Okay, moving to our chapters. Chapters who are normally used to doing a lot of programming in their states had to get really creative and do a lot of things online. And they did, and they stayed active, and many of them just came up with other ways to do things. And I hope people are starting to go back in person a little bit by now. Special thanks to these particular chapter leaders. There are so many others, but these came to mind for staff who they've been deeply engaged and helpful in all the work at the national office. So just wanted to make sure that these folks were recognized. I'm not gonna read them all. So John, go to the next slide, please. Okay, then we've got Fulbright in the Classroom, which is a fantastic program that brought 40 presentations. They were all online. Hopefully by next year, I think some are gonna start to be back in person. I'd love to see that happen a lot, but there will always be that digital option. Through a seed grant program this year to get the program started, we were able to fund 22 grantees to present to classrooms. And then we just had some amazing success with that. I would tap into a few of them myself because it was digital and they were really fun to watch. So kudos to all of you who helped with that. That program can only grow. It's a wonderful way to reach out and promote the Fulbright program. 75th publication. Okay, so here's my little advertisement. Of all the things, because we couldn't do online in-person events for the 2021 75th, I think personally one of the most wonderful things that came out of the association this year to celebrate was this book called Fulbright Stories. And this is a collection of stories, of your stories and your photographs that were put together in order to just commemorate 75th anniversary. It's a fun, wonderful book. And I encourage you all to buy a lot of copies. And I bought a lot of copies and I'm giving them out to people where I know they're gonna put them someplace public. I mean, I think we should have these in dentist offices and public libraries and just anywhere we can think of, because kids are gonna come along or whoever's gonna come along and read these and go, or take a look, and they're gonna go, oh, that could be me. So this is a fantastic publication, and I just give great kudos to the team who put this together, and I hope you'll all take advantage. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so still in review, we had a very successful annual conference in October. Thank you all to all the presenters, all the participants, all the sponsors. That was a wonderful program to put together, and I can't wait for it not to be digital anymore, and we'll look to John to tell us about 2022, but thank you all. A very special thanks to my friend, Rob Lively, who has, for the last 5 years, taken on the job of program conference chair, which is it's a thankless task, basically, but taking all of the proposals that have been submitted by all of you and others to present and organizing that and working with staff to create a schedule and figuring it all out. And so, and working with a committee of very dedicated readers to help him on that. So if you're out there, Rob, thank you very much. And in 2022 at the conference, we want to see you, but you won't have anything to do. So looking forward to that. And okay, and then also the Cohen Dance selection. Of course, the awardee is always picked on a competitive basis, and we do have Alice Blumenfeld to thank for organizing our committee to select our wonderful awardee. Our travel program did return to life this year, even though it was just one trip. It was amazing that we pulled it off, and thanks to the travel subcommittee and Mary Ellen Schmieder for leading that. And also special thanks to the ED in Iceland, Belinda, who was able to take us on and host a group. So we're glad that we were able to do that. And hopefully that'll launch us for the future. So you'll be seeing more travel programs announced for next year. Let's see, the last thing is just, this is just again, something that we added in 2021, trying to build our resources for returned Fulbrighters. This is just a good resource as we're trying to get more young returning professionals engaged with the association to see the benefits. There's been a lot of work done on creating career counseling, and we're looking at a mentoring program. So anyway, our website for that was improved a lot this year. Okay, next slide. I hope we didn't lose John. John, okay.
Oh, no, I advanced the slide and I'm here. I'm just doing with some things behind the stage.
Okay, sorry.
Not to worry.
I was looking at you and not the slide. I didn't realize it had been advanced, so thank you. Okay, a few more thank yous because we can't stop. So many institutional members this year participated in our programs and individuals. We've just had a great year in terms of fundraising with donors and sponsors. And our task force, again, just wanting to mention a couple of the folks who volunteered their time to help on some of these efforts. Matthew and Ashley were fantastic with the diversity task force. We had lots of advisors, including executive directors from Fulbright Commission serve as advisors to us in our advocacy efforts. And then a special thanks to Venable Law Firm, who does pro bono work, and just we can consult them at any time for work on advocacy. They've been hugely helpful. The chapter advisory board, of course, provides leadership for our chapters, and we thank them. And then Giving Tuesday, we even had some help with interviews. So thank you so much for that. Okay. Next. Okay, so that ends my conclusion of the 2021 review. Again, you can't say thank you enough to all the people out there who are contributing to this, to the mission of this association. So none of this is going to work if we don't have a financially sound organization. And so I'm going to hand it over to Will Vokey, our treasurer, who can catch us up and give you the information I hope that will be helpful to you in knowing that we are secure and sound. Will. Unmute. Will.
Thank you.
There you go.
Hi, everybody. I was expecting to speak with you from Taiwan, but with changes in quarantine policies, I'm still in North Carolina. So happy to be on the same time zone. John, could you run the cursor right up to the top of this? This is the 1921 financials. And if you'll note under a program right at the top, it says that this is for the time from January through October. So this is the financials for the first 10 months of the year. And if you note next to that, we'll show you the 2020 figures as well so that you can get some comparison. We're going to kind of dive into the weeds a little bit here. And please save your questions for later, but we'll be happy to answer all your questions later. If you go down that column of revenue, you'll note that the two big revenue sources for this year have been membership at $283,000 and development at $270,000. And you'll notice that the development is about $80,000 short of where we were last year. And the membership is about $125,000 short of last year. And the reason for that is that November and December are usually our biggest months for both renewals of membership and for donations. So we want to encourage you, if you're out there, to think about a donation to Fulbright Association here in the last month before we enter the new year. John, you'll notice that our revenue also is significantly lower than 2020. Again, it's a COVID year. We're not particularly concerned with that because we'll explain that as we go down a little bit lower. But we do hope that with November and December that we will be able to show a balanced budget this year. John, could I ask you to intervene here now and let us know what you think November and December are going to be like? Give us a little projection about November and December.
Certainly will. There are a couple of things that will come in terms of revenue. First of all, December is historically our strongest month for fundraising. November was also a strong month for fundraising. At the moment, we're also benefiting from the renewals of membership by a large number of people, both on all levels, the young professionals to seniors, who are renewing thanks to the Fulbright Census campaign that we conducted last year. So folks are renewing as we're speaking. Those renewals are happening right now. We also received after this some larger gifts, as well as a number of monies from sponsorships for the conference, which took place in mid-October. So those monies would not have arrived on the ledger until very recently.
I should note that we're showing you the financials through October because it takes our accountant about 15 days to post the last month. So November is not available yet, but it will be shortly. Again, I want to encourage you to think about a donation or renewing your membership. But now I'd like to look at expenses. If you look down through those expenses, you'll note that we've got them.
Pardon me.
If you look down through the expenses, John, if you could run the cursor over them, just all of them at one point, you'll notice those expenses are by program, essentially. And that obviously includes some portion of staff time for each program that they spend. So salary expenses, for instance, are part of those. So if you look down at total expenses, you'll see that we are $81,000 over revenue right now. So our expenses are over revenue by $81,000. If you look at last year, you'll see that we were over revenue by about $12,000. Let me explain both of those in just a second, but note that the $81,000 is basically the difference in development revenue up above between where we are now and where we were last year. So with a good November and December, we should be okay. John, run down a little bit further then to net assets at the end of the year. Notice that we've got $5,700,000 in net assets. That's essentially an endowment in three categories. And you'll note that the difference between this year and last year, which is the number right up above, $5,197,000, is essentially the gains from the changes in the stock market. Our financial policies allow us to take out of the endowment income and dividends, but not principal, unless there's a special meeting and vote of the board. And the $12,000 in deficit from last year is exactly what we took out of the endowment income, not principal, income, to cover last year. We're hoping not to have to do that this year. We're again very happy with what our endowment is doing. Let me explain to you our principles for the investment of that endowment. There are essentially three or four principles for that. One is we want to have a minimum involvement of staff and board time since none of us are specialists. Two, we want to have as low fees as we can. We are not interested in day trading or quickly trading things and getting fees up. Thirdly, we are looking for growth. But in terms of looking for growth, we are looking to do that conservatively. And we have about a 70-30 balance between equities and fixed assets. And that is rebalanced every year as the year comes to an end. So basically, we are looking to grow our endowment, to use income from the endowment, but not principal, to use income from the endowment occasionally, in our programming, and to have a conservative approach to the endowment. So if you have questions about that, please let me know. John, do you have anything to add on the financials for 21 before we go to the next two slides?
No, just a reminder that this is 10 months, not 12. So right. It's these numbers are not exactly comparable, as Will has said on a number of occasions. The good news is that if you look at 2020 and 2021, despite the pandemic and our inability to hold many events in person, which often drive our revenue, we've managed to stay quite strong and stable financially. This is not the case for many nonprofits around the country and around the world, unfortunately. But for us, it has been a time when we have shepherded our resources very carefully. And these numbers testify to that.
I was going to note it later, but let me note it now. If you look at the revenue again up above, I pointed out that it's primarily membership and development. You'll see there's very little revenue from activities, from programs, conferences, Fulbright Prize, et cetera. And that will change next year, we hope. We don't know what is happening with COVID, but we hope that next year becomes an in-person year. So we're expecting, and you'll see it in the budget in a minute, we're expecting an additional $600,000 in revenue with associated expenses because of programming activity. So John, if you could flip to the next slide, you can see that this is where is there a revenue side? Did you skip to John? There we go.
No, this expenditures first.
Okay. You'll see that our expenditures are about 37% on administration. That's up this year, and it was up last year, primarily because we had no in-person programming. That will go down next year, we expect. John, next slide. And you'll note that in terms of our income, it's primarily development and primarily memberships. That will go up next year, and you will see those other triangles on the graph increase dramatically when the programming comes back with conference, Fulbright Prize, et cetera. Next slide, John. So this is our 22 budget. This is to be presented to the board actually this coming Friday. The Finance Committee has been over it and has approved it. Let me mention one more thing before I forget about this current year before we go on to 2022. We had an $80,000 loan, a COVID loan, a PPP loan from the government. That loan has now been forgiven thanks to the good accounting of John and Alvaro, our accountant. So that will now go into revenue for this year as well. And we're very happy about that. John, Alvaro, congratulations on that. That was last year. So now we move on to this coming year. You'll note that the membership revenue, the sum of the first two lines, is pretty similar to what we had done in the past. I would point out that the bottom line, $1,648,000, is very similar to the amounts of money that were in the budget and which we spent and had income for in 2019. So we are basically moving back to a standard programming. There are grant lines in this budget, which there weren't before. We're expecting much of that to go to chapters. I want to mention the endowment draw. We are going to be drawing $130,000 from the endowment. $80,000 of that goes towards the prize, and that comes from a special part of the endowment, which is designated for the prize, and that's what that is there for. So that's a normal thing when we offer a prize. The other $50,000 is a new draw from the endowment, and that $50,000 is going to go to chapters. We are hoping that that is matched by a $100,000 grant from the Department of State, from the Bureau of Education and Cultural Affairs. So hopefully this coming year we'll have $150,000 we'll be able to pass on to chapters. That's a new policy by the board to start using some of the endowment income to support programming for the Fulbright Association. Again, I would note sponsors and registrations. If you note those two numbers, both in the $250,000-$280,000 range, that's new revenue this year that we basically don't have for last year, simply because we didn't have any programming. That then is the income budget for this coming year, $1,648,000. Here is the expense budget for this year. And we've given you this budget in a different format. We gave you the 2021 budget in a format which shows the income and cost by program. This is actually the net expenses by audit category. And you will note down at the bottom of this that we expect a net income of $7,000. So in other words, we're presenting essentially a balanced budget with the income draw from the endowment that we have just explained. Obviously, the single biggest expense in any association like this is salaries and benefits, but those salaries and benefits get parsed out to the various programs so that many of the programs help bear the cost of those salaries and benefits. John, do you have anything else you'd like to add?
No, these categories are quite clear. We are a small nonprofit and we take very seriously how we spend our monies. So you can see that the way that we prioritize is with our people. I'll be introducing our staff in just a moment, but our people power our programming. And that's why the investment is significant and important. But you'll also see there are other line items that are significant. Meeting expenses, this has to do with the expenses associated with launching the conference and the prize. That's a large ticket item. Another thing I would draw your attention to is the chapter support. That was the 50K that Will just made reference to. And the other is these monies that go to chapters. Not only are they getting money through all the grants that we just spoke of, but there is a membership rebate that the chapters receive depending on the number of members that they have in their geographic area. So that gives you a sense of our priorities.
Well, sorry. I did see a quick question in the chat about what is the average or approximate principal of the total endowment principal?
The endowment principal as of the 10/31 this year was $5,700,000.
Thank you.
Is the number at the bottom of the asset. And John, click back up to that.
We're heading that way. Here we go.
One more. Right down at the bottom. $5,730,000 is the net assets. That's essentially the endowment at this point. Of course, we don't know how that's going to go, right? I mean, that's heavily market dependent. But our pro bono advisor who helps balance the portfolio and conservatively invest that has done a wonderful job. So I think, John, when you came on board 4 or 5 years ago now, I think the endowment was at like $3,800,000, something like that. So that's been the growth in the last few years.
And right? I take total credit for all of that.
I think you should, John. You had a remarkable impact upon
me and the global economy. Right? Yes, thank you. Appreciate that.
I think, are there any other chat questions on that?
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Will. Well, I'm gonna take my part of the presentation right now. We'll try to get to your questions as soon as possible. So I will race through these as best I can. But please put in the chat any questions that you have for the three of us on any topic. That can also be suggestions, ideas, things you'd like to talk about. If you would like me to reach out to you directly, I'm happy to do that. Let me know. You can also send me a note to john@fulbright.org. So thank you again for participating. And let me introduce my great team. So I'm delighted that I am surrounded by talent and hardworking, imaginative people who are working very hard for all of you every day. We've been joined this year by Alicia Montague, who is our director for national events. Alicia comes to us from NASPA, the National Association of Student Affairs Professionals. She's a longtime events expert, and she has already dived into planning and executing our Fulbright Prize, which I'll tell you more about in a minute, as well as the conference, in addition to the Fulbright forums. So Alicia is already delivering extraordinary work, and I'm delighted for that. Munir Sayeh is our director for data and communications. Munir, like myself, is a Fulbrighter. He to Egypt, myself to India. Munir is after me, the most senior staff member at the Fulbright Association. And the driving force behind the 75th anniversary publication, all of our communications and newsletters that we send to you all the time, as well as the Fulbright Census Project, which has helped us find tens of thousands of Fulbrighters for whom we had no contact information. We also have a new assistant director for philanthropy, Claire Jagla. Claire is a Fulbrighter to South Korea. So now half of our team are Fulbright alums. Claire was a very successful fundraiser for Teach for America, and she joined us in July, doing a fantastic job building strong relations with our donor pool. Feel free to join that pool anytime. Christine Oswald is our assistant director for chapters and institutions, working with chapters on a daily basis, communicating to all of you out there. Christine is doing also a terrific job. She's been with us for a couple of years, and building those relationships has been a very important part of her terrific work. And finally, Fiona Breslin. Fiona has been with the Fulbright Association for a number of years, first as an intern and now as a manager for membership and the office itself. Fiona answers all of your calls and emails every day. She is at our front line of helping all of you with any issues, questions that you might have. Fiona is also an amazing addition to our team. She's also helping us relocate. The Fulbright Association is actually going to move to another office space in Washington, D.C. That is more appropriate to the hybrid work environment that we now live in, saving money and therefore directing more of our resources to mission, which is so critical. And Fiona has been spearheading that. The year ahead.
John, if I might, this is Will. Wanted to tell the members that during the pandemic, the staffing went down because some people moved on, and we kept that down until really this fall, when we are back now at those six staff members that John mentioned, which is a full-time staffing load. So I think we were responsible in terms of salaries and benefits during the key parts of COVID, and we are now staffed back up to a full staff. So, John,
exactly,
thank you.
Exactly. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit about the year ahead. First, the headline is that we will be giving the Fulbright Prize to Bono, the great musician and activist, in late March here in Washington. We're finalizing a few details, and we'll be announcing this to the membership very shortly. There'll be opportunities to come to the event as a sponsor, as a registrant. All those details will be coming to you next week. But I'm very excited about the ability to bring our community together to celebrate this extraordinary human being and his work, and finally to be in the same room with each other, which is going to be terrific. That being said, we'll also have a live stream for all members and anyone else across the world. So I'm looking forward to enjoying that evening with all of you. Our chapters are once again launching in-person programming in 2022. We're very excited about that. Will has mentioned the resources that we want to share with them in order to support that. The Fulbright Forum will continue to offer programming on a largely on a monthly basis, the kinds of webinars that Dee Dee made reference to. Fulbright in the Classroom will, of course, continue, as she mentioned. We're also launching a new program called Great Decisions. This is a program in partnership with the Foreign Policy Association, which offers a curriculum for encouraging meaningful conversation over foreign policy issues. These will be handled through a number of our chapters. So if you're interested in Great Decisions, I hope you'll find a way to participate in that. You can always reach out to my colleague, Christine at Fulbright.org, who is taking the lead on that program. We are We are opening up a new program in 2022, a mentoring program to help connect young professionals with more experienced Fulbrighters to offer them guidance and support. We think it's very important that we support there's a cross-generational support system. We're working on that for 2022. Once again, we will have an advocacy month in April. We're going to do this virtually again. We, as Dee Dee mentioned, this was so successful the first time around that we decided that the in-person experience that we have engineered in past pre-COVID years was actually less effective than these digital connections. That was a sort of surprising conclusion from COVID, but we hope all of you can participate in that. It's very important that we have voices, your voices, from across the country. So I do hope you'll look to participate whenever you can in advocacy. We'll once again restart our travel program with plans to return to Slovenia, which has been postponed a number of times, as well as a very new idea to travel within the physical boundaries of the United States to the Cherokee Nation. It's critically important that we are united as a country and we understand each other within our physical boundaries. So I think this is an exciting opportunity to partner with Native Americans, and we look forward to your participation there. And finally, our annual conference, which will take place in person here in the DC area in October. More details to come. We very much hope you'll be engaged in that as well. I just have one more slide and then we'll get to your questions. So here we go. How can we stay involved? There are well north of 100 of you on this call. It's fantastic that you're on there. So thank you for joining us. But you may be thinking, well, what can I do? How can I help? Well, this list you see on your screen here offers a lot of opportunities for you to get involved. I won't read them all, but I do think it's important that you think about how do you, as a Fulbrighter, extend the mission in your life? How is it that you can continue to embrace those values and the importance of promoting international understanding and peace? What role can I play? Now, it's there are many opportunities here. Some of them are more involved than others, but I certainly hope you'll consider doing one, more, all of them. Many of you already do, which I'm deeply grateful. So give that some thought as the weeks and months come roll on. Okay, so Dee Dee, Will, and I are happy to answer your questions, take your comments. I'll go to the Q&A, where we have questions. The first from Geraldine: it seems like the chapters at maximum will get about a third of the usual amount. Geraldine, I'm not sure what you mean by the usual amount, but one of the things I think you're referring to is that the chapter grant is not probably will not be as large as it has been pre-COVID. And that just reflects budget cuts within the State Department and a shrinking amount of resources available from them. That's the reason why we're stepping up with our own resources to give to chapters. How will the chapter...
John, let me just add to that. That's one of the reasons we decided to use some of the income from the endowment towards the chapters, is because the grant that had normally come from the State Department is unlikely to be as large as it used to be. But I don't think it's as low as one third what the chapters normally received if you put all those numbers together.
Yeah, it's not.
Thank you.
Exactly. An anonymous question comes, how will the chapter allocations be determined and for what purpose? So the membership rebates, or as I mentioned, come back to members depending on the number of members in their jurisdiction. So that is affected by a simple calculation. The The rest of the chapter grant system will work a lot like we have in the past, where we will have a call for proposal that we will send out to chapters. But we plan to do this on a rolling basis. We're working on all the details of this, and we will let chapter leaders know how we're going to do this. But we, Christine and I, want to improve this system to be more flexible and less burdensome to all of you who apply for these grants. Let's see. We have a question from Deborah Boyd. What is Fulbright in the classroom? An excellent question. So, Deborah, I invite you to go to our website, fulbright.org, and see all the details there. But in a nutshell, the idea here is that Fulbrighters here in the United States are interested in sharing their experiences with young people. These are students K through college, where I'll give my own example. So I went to India, so I might make an appointment with the teacher here at our local school, Tilden Middle School, in collaboration with the faculty to go and talk about India. This has happened all over the country, Indiana, Iowa, Florida, California, Texas, all over the place, where Fulbrighters are going to classrooms to share their experiences and knowledge and love of a foreign country. This is one of our main signature programs for community outreach. I hope that gives you a little sense of what that's like. We have a longer question here. Could we have a link showing that we are members of Fulbright on our CVs? We can link membership, but that gives access to details. I think what you're driving at here is the ability to network. So this is very important. One of the tools that we haven't mentioned on this call is the Fulbrighter app, which is available to all our members, in fact, to all Fulbrighters. On the Fulbrighter app, I think I'll ask Munir if he could, in the chat, put the link to the Fulbrighter app. You can effectively post your credentials, your CV, and so on, and you can build a professional network through that app. They're also on our membership profile. You can put more details about your professional life, and that is very helpful to us, so that we can better connect you to others with similar interests. I think I'm answering too many of these questions, Dee Dee and Will, but here we go.
No, that's all right. You're doing great.
Okay, thanks.
I was trying to look through the chats too, but.
Yeah, so do you see anything in the chat? I'm looking at the Q&A.
I did see there was a question. I got lost, but I did see there was a question about the selection process for the prize, and which I'll just comment very briefly on.
Please do.
The last prize selection committee was put together in 2020, and that comprised the chair of the Fulbright board, obviously sits on that committee, as well as several people that are picked kind of internationally. So it depends on the two co-chairs for the last selection committee was David Bradley and Mary Ellen Schmieder. And I participated on that as well with some international representatives. So each year that we have a prize selection that's put together. In 2020, we took nominations from everywhere. Whenever that happens again, you'll see it. We'll solicit nominations anywhere we can think of. It's, again, you don't have to be a Fulbrighter, obviously, to be selected for the prize. It normally goes not to Fulbrighters. But in any case, it's a vast solicitation for nominations, and then the committee meets and they resolve and they come up with a recommendation for a laureate, and that laureate is extended an invitation and accepts or does not. And that process happened in 2020. And it's simply because of the pandemic that we had to put it on hold until international travel was back and we could safely offer a ceremony that's worthy of the laureate. So I hope that answers your questions.
Thank you, Didi. Will, a question that you might be willing to answer. Has the board considered a socially responsible investing strategy for the endowment?
Yes, we've looked at that and we've talked about it. And at this point, we haven't done that. We are invested in essentially mutual fund type vehicles and have tried with those points I made to keep both board time and expense at a minimum. And as our advisors have suggested, there is also a trade-off between defining an investment strategy that looks at particular things and overall growth. So there's a strategy between generating overall growth and investing in socially responsible activities. We've encouraged our investment advisor to look at socially responsible activities, but we don't have a specific set of activities that we are investing in. So I would say we're about halfway there. And we're concerned, of course, with the idea that any decline in income or growth is essentially a decline in funds available to the Fulbright Association, which itself is dedicated to socially responsible activities. So there's a little bit of a conundrum in that. But it's an issue that's been raised by several people, and we continue to think and work on it and try to figure out the best way to meet that while meeting the goal, the income goals necessary for the association.
A question came in about what efforts are underway to make DEI efforts central to all we do. The racial reckoning is still impacting how we all operate. So I'll say something on this, and Didi can add to this. Of course, we have been very self-reflecting during this period about the issues that that you're referring to, and the fact that the Fulbright legacy and the Fulbright program itself has challenges to meet many of these ideas. For example, the fact that the Fulbright program does not adequately represent everyone in the United States. It tends to be skewed in directions that are historically unfair. We are doing the efforts that we can to, for example, through Fulbright in the classroom, to rectify that as best we can. Trying our Fulbright in the classroom grant program, for example, is specifically targeted at underrepresented classrooms. In other words, we are going to HBCUs, we're going to minority serving institutions, we're going to rural areas, we're going to places where Fulbrighters are not well represented. And that's an important piece to our priorities. Didi, if you'd like to add to this, maybe talk about the task force.
Yeah, I don't have that much to add, except that obviously we in our way of attempting to address these complex issues, we did put together a group of people who helped us through some workshops, and we've got people like Matthew and Ashley who really helped us think through some of the issues related to diversity and inclusion. The work of that committee came up with recommendations, one of which that be a permanent working group within the board to continue that conversation, to try to make it action oriented and to build it into our programming. So we're aware, we're working at it. We have a long way to go. I would say sometimes that people, there's a lot of work that can be done within the Fulbright program itself. But we, as the Alumni Association, have a role in that, but we're not direct, you know, we're not directly related to that. So it's hard to separate out the issues, but within the things that we can control, we're very attentive, and we'd be very open to any thoughts you have. I mean, if you have suggestions or things that we should be considering in our work, please don't hesitate to let us know.
A final note on this is that we have been working throughout this year with a series of Fulbright affinity groups. These are groups that have been organized around D&I questions. For example, Fulbright Prism is for the gay, lesbian, LGBTQ community. Fulbright Noir for African Americans connected to Fulbright. So we have been collaborating with them on a regular basis, offering them opportunities to present at our conference, to run a, for example, a Fulbright, the Fulbright Prism ran a Fulbright Forum back in June. Lots of opportunities for collaboration. We are a work in progress, like all of us. And as Dee Dee suggests, we are open to suggestion and input. Another question comes from David Johnson. How can I find a list of chapters nationally and contacts? David, visit Fulbright.org, where you'll see on our navigation tab, a tab for chapters. That provides a map of the United States where you can zoom in and find the contact information for every chapter. If that does not meet with where you are, we would love to talk to you about perhaps starting a chapter wherever you are. Again, Christine at Fulbright.org, a good contact point for that.
It just made me think of something I wanted to throw out there, and I'm probably as guilty of this as anyone, but if all of you have completely filled out your profile in the membership part of the association, I mean, kudos to you, but I often forget myself to add changes or things that have happened, but please complete your profile, because we only know as much about the membership as you tell us, and it does really, really help when we've got more information. So if you go into your profile, it'd be nice for you to complete that, fill it out. Yeah, Will.
There's a question here from Francis Novak, asks to keep us periodically aware of the condition of incoming international Fulbrighters and what's happening during the pandemic. I just wanted to kind of clarify, which I think everyone understands, that the Fulbright Association is not a part of the government and doesn't have access to the information that comes from all the Fulbright programs through government channels around the world. We get our information about incoming Fulbrighters and outgoing Fulbrighters on a secondhand basis. So it's very difficult for us to keep up with the condition of incoming international Fulbrighters as much as we would like to. We try to do that. That's important to us, but we do not have access to those government databases that show who's coming and who's going.
Well, there's some more questions being posed in the chat. I'm just trying to scan through it because there are lots of great comments here too. And I draw your attention to these. My team has put some links to various programs and opportunities in there. Let's see if I can find a question.
Actually, on the incoming Fulbrighters, that's a lot of why we value, one of the many reasons we value the work of the chapters, is because at the local level, the chapters are often connected to the local universities who are hosting the incoming Fulbrighters, and that's a good way of tapping the pulse and understanding their well-being. So we really do appreciate the work of the chapters who do reach out in their local communities to the incoming Fulbrighters.
Another note. So I think we've gone through most of the questions, Will and Dee Dee. One thing I wanted to update you all on is that our continuing efforts regarding Fulbrighters in Afghanistan. We posted our support for these Fulbrighters back in August, but we've been doing work ever since then. In particular, working with the office of Congressman John Garamendi, a congressman from California. Garamendi has proposed a bill that would allow for Fulbrighters in Afghanistan to receive priority for visas in order to relocate to the United States. We asked many of you to sign a petition, not sign a petition, but to contact your member of Congress to ask that they co-sponsor this bill. Thousands of you responded to that. We're grateful for that action. We're following that up with a series of meetings that we're scheduling in the next couple of weeks targeted at key decision makers on the House side. So just want you to know that we're still working hard on that.
John, I just noticed one other comment that we did not respond to. It was a suggestion that there be more service component from Ms. Shippey Rice, a more service component in the travel programs. And I think we ought to forward that on to the travel subcommittee.
Yeah, it is. It's true that the travel program has had what they've called a service corps, which is that on a regular basis, they have made public service and outreach an important part of travel programs. That has been difficult to do for a couple of years for obvious reasons, but the suggestion is a good one, and a number of the travel subcommittee members are on this call right now. I'm sure they're hearing that right now. Let me see if there's one more question that we can answer before we shut down here. A good question about sustainability and the environment. We have not, as an organization, looked carefully at these issues beyond using our platforms as an important place for debate on climate change, on sustainability, and the like. So, for example, we held a Fulbright forum earlier this spring on sea rising, sea levels changing, and how that's affecting coastal communities across the world. We've had important parts of our conference devoted to environmental issues. This is another area that we could spend more time on, and I would welcome any engagement on that. All right, Dee Dee, why don't you wrap us up? We're already
A minute or two just over. A bit over. I'm just so thrilled that so many people linked in and you had a listen and joined us today. Thank you. We didn't know who to expect, but it's very gratifying to see the interest and participation. So I just want to thank all of you out there for being a part of this conversation. Again, we couldn't do this without our noble team. John Bader and his full staff are to be commended for all the good work that they've done. And we'll just keep moving forward, and we look forward to 2022. And I think that closes the business meeting for 2021.
Thank you all. Take care. Happy holidays. Be safe.
Happy holidays.
And please stay in touch. We appreciate your support and your engagement. Take care.
Bye.